wonder if you remember where you were when Queen Elizabeth II was crowned. Or perhaps you remember where you were when JFK was assassinated. Or perhaps even where you were when Neil Armstrong landed on the moon. Well, I don't, because I wasn't even a glimmer of a glimmer in my mother's eye. But I do remember where I was 10 years ago in late October. I remember that I was slimmer, I was less grey, I had fewer children, and a bit more time and money. And I remember very well sitting in the basement study of my Anglican rectory in Calgary and refreshing continually the Holy See Press Office section of the Vatican website, because I'd heard that something momentous was about to be announced by Pope Benedict. And when the news eventually came through on the website that the Holy Father would be promulgating an apostolic constitution to, and I quote, provide for such corporate reunion by establishing personal ordinariates, which will allow former Anglicans to enter full communion with the Catholic Church, while preserving elements of the distinctive Anglican spiritual and liturgical patrimony. Well, I certainly remember my reaction. I cheered. Actually, I yelled loudly, very loudly. And then with tears in my eyes, I ran up the stairs into the kitchen, and after just about frightening to death my long-suffering wife, I exclaimed, "He's done it! He's finally done it," before then rambling on without a pause of breath about what it all meant for us, for our parish, and for the future. This was the fulfillment of so many hopes and prayers. A means to allow a corporate reunion of Anglicans into the fullness of communion with the Holy See. Of course, it would be another 2 years before my parishioners and I were finally able to embrace that long-desired unity, but I'd already bought my trunks and my towel, and I was more than ready to join the Tiber swim team. But beyond the immediate glee, when the dust of Pope Benedict's ecumenical bomb had settled, came the time for serious study and reflection. How would this constitution, this legal document, Anglicanorum Coetibus, affect my spiritual life, my ordained life? What if God didn't choose to call me to be a Catholic priest? Ordination wasn't automatic. There was a process, a new testing, further study. What would it mean for me to set aside my Anglican ministry, my identity? What about all those masses that I thought I'd said, the confessions I'd heard, the blessings I'd imparted? Don't get me wrong, I was 110% signed up to going over to Rome, as we would have said, and I told my people that I'd love them to join me. But would they come? Reassurance and hope came from a familiar quarter. John Henry Newman had trodden this path before, and in times more controversial than in 2009. And soon enough, his feelings and thoughts, his experience, his words became my own. I can only say, if it is necessary to say it, that from the moment I became a Catholic, I never had, through God's grace, a single doubt or misgiving on my mind that I did wrong in becoming one. I have not had any feeling whatever but one of joy and gratitude that God called me out of an insecure state into one which is sure and safe, out of the war of tongues and into the realm of peace and assurance. Newman, who spent 45 years as an Anglican and 45 years as a Catholic, knew the difference between an insecure state and one that was sure and safe, between the war of tongues and the realm of peace and assurance. What have the Romans ever done for us? Says Reg in Monty Python's Life of Brian. Well, Rome welcomed me, affirmed me, called me, and loved me more than I'd ever been in that insecure state of the War of Tongues in my former dispensation. And furthermore, she asked me to serve in this great ordinariat endeavour of a lifetime. Anglicanorum Coetibus is no mere legal document, then. It's a wholesome medicine, a spiritual restorative, a tonic for heart, soul, mind and body, a life-giving and grace-filled opportunity for Anglicans to unpack, breathe, and share our spiritual treasures of Ecclesia Anglicana, the English Church, and also receive them in return from the mother from which we'd been hewn 5 centuries earlier. As one of the original founders of the Oxford movement, we owe St. John Henry a profound sense of gratitude for his part in helping the Anglican Church to recover much of what it lost at the Reformation. His groundwork paved the way for the Anglo-Catholic movement. Indeed, I don't think it's too much to say that without him we really wouldn't be where we are today. Newman was ahead of his time in praying for the reunion of Anglicans with the Catholic Church, and his own conversion, as we know, scandalized Oxford and cost him friends, family, and colleagues. 167 years later, here in Canada, many of those of us who were Anglicans made a similar move, and in some instances, in similar circumstances. Our receptions across this dominion into the full communion of the Church were historic and joyful occasions, a fact that's written all over the happy faces that one can see on the photographs taken of each group being received. The sense of relief is palpable and joy. As with the prodigal son, we were welcomed home with open arms. Newman's calling by God out of his insecurity into the surety and safety of the Catholic Church has been true for those of us who trod this path towards true, realized ecumenism. Our respective moves took us from a state of schism with the Catholic Church, created in the crucible of the English Reformation, into a new and assured dwelling place. In many ways, therefore, this has been our homecoming. Like Newman, we've left behind old arguments and issues. We've said goodbye to the old order where many of us, especially those of us in the Anglican Communion, were effectively persona non grata with our bishop and with many of the clergy in our former diocese. That time and that place of uncertainty and anxiety, that war of tongues, if you like, where we actively argued and fought against our own church, is now past. We have, praise God, come into a place of sanctuary and inviolability. In Newman's words, we are no more content to amuse ourselves with dreams and fancies that we could carry on, bearing witness to Catholic truth as Anglicans. We couldn't. We were dying and we were managing decline. And lest anybody get the wrong idea about why we've done what we've done, let me say it loud and clear. It's about Jesus. The War of Tongues may well have been a reason for leaving our former abode, but it could never account for our becoming Catholics. Our homecoming had always to be about Jesus first and foremost, and about the truth of his body, the Church. Without me, says the Lord, you can do nothing. And so we found it to be true. And he, above all, is the one who still suffers on account of our messy disunity. In returning to the fullness of faith in the Catholic Church, we're doing what we can to alleviate and heal his wounded and broken body. Far from being a mere convenience, allowing us to keep some cherished traditions and customs of our Anglican patrimony, our move into the Catholic Church, especially those of us who came from the Anglo-Catholic wing is but a logical and necessary conclusion of our former Anglicanism. In 1933, the centenary year of the Oxford movement, a manifesto was published by the leaders of that movement, which stated in unambiguous terms this: our Lord set up but one church, the members of which were to be in communion with one another. This one church was constituted with St. Peter as its foundation and head, and forever has as its center and guide on earth the successor of St. Peter. One church. 2, 3, or even 3,000 churches do not do the Lord a double or triple honor. Rather, they diminish his glory and wound still more his broken body. Those of us who came from Anglicanism had been, as it were, severed limbs, forced into schism, cut off from the rock and the fullness of the body. But now, as Catholics who honor and value all that was good and of beauty in our Anglican tradition, who value all that taught, nourished, and urged us on towards the fullness of Catholic communion, we have secured that unity which Christ so earnestly willed. And we can now look forward in our realm of peace and assurance towards years of stability and growth. Work, yes, but good work, as we enjoy our newfound freedom to proclaim without let or hindrance one church, one faith, one Lord, no doubts, no misgivings. What have the Romans ever done for us? Well, 10 years ago they gave us Anglicanorum Coetibus, so that inspired by the Holy Spirit, the hearts of God's faithful people, these groups of Anglicans, might be taught and enabled to have a right judgment in all things, and so evermore to rejoice in his holy comfort.
Even do truly and earnestly repent from your sins and are a double charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways. Draw near with faith and make a humble confession to Almighty God, meeting me with my mornings. Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge to beware of our manifold sins and wickedness, which we deed from time to time most grievously have committed, by fault, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and our heart is sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
May Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, of his great mercy, have promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him. Have mercy on us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us with all goodness, bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ said to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail under our heavy burden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sins. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
Accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices. We offer them unto thee first for thy holy Catholic Church, that thou vouchsafe to keep her in peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with thy servant Francis, our Pope, Stephen, our Bishop,
all the faithful guardians of the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids. And all who here around us stand, whose faith is known unto thee, and their steadfastness manifest, on whose behalf we offer unto thee, or who themselves offer unto thee, this sacrifice of praise, for themselves and for all who are theirs, for the redemption of their souls, for the hope of their health and well-being, and who offer their prayers unto thee, the eternal God, the living and the true. United in one communion, we venerate the memory first of the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, of Blessed Joseph, her spouse, as also of thy blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Thaddeus, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John, Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and of all thy saints. Grant that by their merits and prayers we may in all things be defended with the help of thy protection. We beseech thee then, O Lord, graciously to accept this oblation from us thy servants and from thy whole family. Order thou our days in thy peace, and bid us to be delivered from eternal damnation and to be numbered in the fold of thine. Vouchsafe, O God, we beseech thee in all things, to make this oblation blessed, approved, and accepted, a perfect and worthy offering, that it may become for us the body and blood of thy dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Who the day before he suffered, took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes lifted up to heaven, unto thee, God, his almighty Father, giving thanks to thee, he blessed, broke, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given for you. After supper, taking also this goodly chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to thee, he blessed, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. incited by divine majesty, that all we with this partaking of the altar shall receive the most sacred body and blood of thy Son, may be fulfilled with all heavenly benediction and graces. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids who have gone before us, sealed with the seal of faith, and who speak the speech of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech thee to grant the abode of refreshing, of light, and of peace. To us sinners also, thy servants, who hope in the multitude of thy mercies, vouchsafe to grant some part and fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, with John, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicitas, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and with all thy saints, within whose fellowship we beseech thee admit us, not weighing on our own, but granting us forgiveness through Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom, O Lord, thou dost ever create all these good things, to sanctify, quicken, bless, and bestow them upon us.
By whom and with whom and in whom, to thee, O Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory throughout all ages, world without end.
Amen.
As our Savior Christ hath commanded and taught us, we be our bold to say,
the peace of the Lord.